Good afternoon, honorable leaders, prime ministers, your excellencies and dear colleagues, executive secretary, she is a close friend of mine. And first of all, I would like to express our appreciation, in fact, for having this opportunity to provide some information regarding the G20 agenda and also the Turkish presidency's priorities. And your executive secretary, in fact, our executive secretary, Madame Shamsat, is very, very active within the G20. And she is the voice, strong voice of the UN, in fact. And she defends the interests of the UN and the development agenda very strongly within the G20. She makes a very valuable contribution. So we all appreciate, in fact, her role in the G20. Let me say, start a few words. When I read the priorities of this commission meetings, I was pleasantly surprised because of most of the themes, mainly three items, main points, are identical with the Turkish presidency's priorities. Namely, I mean, we summarize the Turkish presidency's priorities as the three I's: inclusiveness, implementation, and investment for growth, infrastructure investment for growth. These are the items, in fact, you have been dealing in ESCAP, in this, especially this commission meetings. Before I start, in fact, I mean, giving more detailed information regarding these priorities, maybe I should start what we are doing within the G20. G20, of course, I mean, the main area of the G20 when it was established after the Asian crisis and the Russian crisis was to deal with the financial, establish again the financial stability of the global economy. And then in 2008, when we had this very severe, let's say, financial crisis, and the process was elevated to the leaders, level. Since then, we hold all the G20 meetings, summits at the levels of the leaders. And Turkey will hold its own summit in November 15 and 16 in Antalya. Until that time, we are almost, I mean, we started our presidency last year in December, and we are halfway of the year, in fact, our presidency. We have a very ambitious program, and but we think that we are making a good progress. I would like to express my appreciations and the good works about our presidency from the executive secretary. When we started our presidency, in fact, we decided that we will be introducing two main cross-cutting teams within the G20 under every work streams. First one is a development, LIDCs, low income and developing countries, and the second one is SMEs, small and medium-sized enterprises. What we have been doing, I will explain in more detail when I touch upon the main, let's say, agenda items of the G20. Of course, I mean, G20 has a multi-year agenda. Every presidency, I mean, continuity is very important. We do have a troika system. Now, I mean, Australia, previous presidents of the G20, and China is the incoming president. And we work together, Australia, Turkey, and China, in order to ensure the continuity, because we have global challenges, and we need global answers, which require, in fact, multi-year agenda processes. I would like to express my appreciation and for the successful Australian presidency. I always say that we inherited a very good legacy from the Australian presidency. I am sure, hopefully, that we will leave a good heritage also to the Chinese presidency. And within the GTS, as I said, I mean, the core of the agenda since the start of the establishment of the G20 has been the financial stability. That's why, I mean, our finance ministers and Bank of Governors, in fact, they meet four times a year in order to deal with the current economic situation. And they met the second time during our presidency in April. And I will just share with you some of the, let's say, challenges which have been indicated by our finance ministers. First of all, I guess volatility in exchange rates, low inflation, sometimes deflationary pressures, and also volatility in exchange in financial markets, and also diverging, let's say, monetary policies have been determined as the main, let's say, points of challenges for the global economy. And especially this year, our finance ministers also focused on the drop of oil prices, sharp drop of oil prices, because it is having effect, of course, on the global economy. It is having some positive effect on importing countries, but also it is taking some toll on exporting countries. But according to the IMF, in fact, there is an assessment overall that we will be benefiting all, I mean, from this sharp drop of oil prices. But still, I mean, it brings some uncertainties because we do not know how will the, I mean, evolve the prices in the future. But overall, there is an estimation it will have a, let's say, give additional 0.5 percentage of additional growth to the GDP over global economy. That's a good news. And we can say that as the G20, now the financial system is more resilient. I mean, in comparison, of course, what happened in 2008, due to the very, let's say, strong efforts of the G20, now with the banking, stronger banking resolutions and many decisions, we can say that we can take a pride as the G20 from a more resilient financial system. And of course, I mean, there are some questions when I go to some outreach activities. When you are not within the club, I mean, within the G20, there are questions, there are concerns, and people, let's say, identify G20 as a platform only concerned with their own interests, which is not true, because I think maybe this is our mistake. We need to make, let's say, more effort to get the message across more rightly. Because, for example, with this more resilient financial system, now the global economy is on more balance and on the right track. But still we have a long, I mean, let's say, work we need to do together with the rest of the economies. Because first of all, I mean, the global economy, unfortunately, is not growing what we expected for. And it is moderate, it is slow, and it is uneven across many countries and regions. That is one of the primary focus of the G20. That's why last year, in fact, we decided with our common commitments to increase the GDP of the G20 collectively by another additional 2.1% in 5 years' time period, which we call this 2 in 5 target. And in order to reach that goal, in fact, member countries committed ourselves to do many, policy measures, implementing many policy measures, approximately more than 1,000. And this year we said that's a very, important goal. Especially when we take into account the slow growth of the world economy. But there are some criticism, about the G20. They say that G20 talk too much, but they do not deliver. Now it is time, in fact, to turn our words into action. That is why we, in fact, identified one of the first priorities of the Turkish presidency this year, implementation. We will have we are working, having a very robust monitoring mechanism, and we are saying that let's hold ourselves accountable. We will have a very strong accountability process. Hopefully, we are working on that. We will have the first accountability report by the end of our presidency in Antalya. Then the G20, we will be more proud, to say that now, we have fulfilled, at least, we will see what we have been doing with our commitments. This is not only limited, in fact, to this additional growth rate, but also, for example, G20 have committed themselves also to, decrease the gender gap by 25% by 2025, which means, more labor force of women participating in the labor force. In order to reach that goal, we are saying that, let's have some kind of monitoring mechanism, which means implementation. I think this is a very important target because according to some figures, if we can achieve this target, we will bring additional 100 million women workforce into the labor market. And World Economic Forum, in fact, indicates that if we can increase only 1% of the women force, we will add $80 billion to the world economy, which shows the significance of this, commitment. That's why, we put a very high emphasis on implementation. And also and inclusiveness is your team, which shows that, since most of the teams are identical, which shows us that Turkish presidency on the right path. We have chosen very right, teams. Inclusiveness, because growth is not sufficient, the quality of growth is important. The growth needs to be inclusive. All the segments of the societies need to benefit from the welfare which has been created by more growth. But which is not the case, in fact. We are seeing that the increasing inequality across G20 countries. Let me give one figure. Among the OECD countries, in fact, the inequality is the highest level in 30 years. Of course, inequality is a social and political phenomenon. We all have a, moral obligation to deal with inequality. But also, there are lots of studies, indicating that the rising inequality, in fact, hampers economic growth. Now it has become a very important obstacle in front of, more growth. That's why economically also we need to address this problem. And during our presidency, in fact, How we look at inclusiveness, in fact? We say that there are two levels we will be looking. We are looking at, inequality and inclusiveness. First of all, within nations. Within nations means G20 countries, but also among countries, which brings the development LIDCs, in fact, into the picture. And of course, I mean, G20, this is not the only the Turkish presidency's creation. We have integrated development agenda since the Korean presidency, since 2010. But this year, we know that is a very special year for development, especially, I mean, we will have the third conference on financing for development in Addis Ababa in July, and then the sustainable SDGs summit in New York in September, and COP21 in Paris in December. And I say that, I mean, I'm not quite sure whether we are lucky or unlucky, since, I mean, the pressure is increasing, of course, on the Turkish presidency to deliver some, let's say, meaningful results from the G20. But I can assure you that we are working very hard, in fact, at least to give very strong political messages to these three processes. For development, I mean, for the LIDCs, what we have been doing under the Turkish presidency, we have introduced, in fact, LIDC perspective under every work stream of the G20. Whatever we do, I mean, in every work stream, we always say what we are doing for the LIDCs, what we will be the, let's say, our additional value for the LIDCs. For example, I will give you a couple of examples on that. Last year, we adopted energy principles. In fact, this was the first time within the G20 that now we have energy principles. And these principles, 10 principles. And as the Turkish presidency, we said that, I mean, among all these principles, we will give a high priority to the principle of access to energy for all. I think this is a very important item. In fact, I mean, this is the one of the first conditions of development. And then we said that we will be focusing on sub-Saharan Africa. Of course, I mean, there are two main regions. One is Africa, the other one is Asia, in fact, which is the energy is mostly needed regions. But I am sure that, I mean, because these principles will continue for the next, for the coming presidencies, they will focus on Asia specifically. For the sub-Saharan Africa, why we have chosen sub-Saharan Africa? In fact, I mean, let's first of all put the figure, 1.3 billion people do not have an access to electricity. This is a very serious phenomenon. And in sub-Saharan Africa, in fact, out of 900 million, more than 900 million, 650 million people do not have an access to electricity. That's why we put a special emphasis on sub-Saharan Africa. We will try, but the most important things for all the agenda items of the G20, for the LIDCs, we need to attract investors, in fact. Because we know that, I mean, there is an ample of liquidity in the market, but the most important thing is to appeal institutional investors. But what the institutional investors are looking for, in fact, a very good regulatory framework. For the sub-Saharan Africa, we are trying to put in place a good framework, regulatory framework, for the investors, in fact, to be more, let's say, forthcoming to do investments in sub-Saharan Africa. And within the G20, finance ministers, they meet 4 times, and trade ministers and labor ministers. But in addition to these meetings, in fact, for the second time, we had in the G20 history, we had the agriculture ministers meetings early in this month. At the beginning, in fact, when we said that we will be organizing this meeting, there were some suspicions because agriculture is not always an easy subject because, I mean, national interests, of course, are important. And within the G20, we all make special efforts, in fact, to reach a consensus. And then we said that the main theme of the agriculture ministers' meeting will be sustainable food system, food security and nutrition, with a special focus on food loss and waste. Because I think this is a very highly important issue. We are losing, in fact, almost $1 trillion every year with the production, with the cost of the production of this food waste and loss. If we can lower this to zero, in fact, maybe we can feed 2 trillion people, in fact, more to elevate the pressure on the problem of finding a solution to hunger. I mean, this is not only the this is a problem because we should also accept that half of the poor people live in G20. That's why, I mean, the problems are not aliens, in fact, to the G20. And we had a very successful agriculture ministers meeting, and now we have established a platform with some of the existing mechanism, building on this existing mechanism. FAO will be in charge, in fact, in order, first of all, I think the problem is to have a common measurement system. What is food waste and loss? And then from then, we can go how we can make some progress in order to decrease what will be the roadmap. And we will be doing that. And that's, I mean, it was a very successful meeting. And for the first time this year, we will be also holding energy ministers' meetings. This will be a new development for the G20. And of course, I mean, energy ministers will reflect on the 10 principles of the 10 principles of the energy principles of the G20. But with a special focus, access to energy for all. Before this meeting, back to back with this meeting, we will hold a high level conference. We will be, in fact, inviting non-G20 countries, and of course, I mean, institutional investors and the G20 ministers, they will get together in order to show the significance of the subject and to attract, in fact, more institutional investors. When I come to third, our team is infrastructure investments. You have been also reflecting on that. Because it is a very highly important issue. There is a big infrastructure gap, not only in developing or, I mean, LIDCs, but also in advanced countries. According to OECD, the infrastructure gap, in fact, by 2013, stands at $70 trillion. It's a huge number. And only in Asia, according to the Asian Development Bank, in fact, in 10 years' time, the need for infrastructure in Asia, $8 trillion. That's why, in fact, this year we put a special emphasis on infrastructure investment. And we ask all the member countries to have ambitious national programs to national programs for infrastructure investments. Hopefully, by the end of Antalya, we will have these investment strategies. These investment strategies, of course, I mean, will deal with improving the framework for more investors and the efficiency of the public sector and better, and more, let's say, integrated approach to the private partnership, public private partnership. And that's why, in fact, I mean, hopefully that in Antalya, we will, our leaders will approve that. And last year, it was a very, let's say, good opportunity for our leaders when they had their meetings in Brisbane. They discussed trade very extensively because, I mean, trade is very important for all of us. But unfortunately, what we have been seeing that trade has not been growing as it used to be. Now it is around 3%. It used to be before the 2008 financial crisis, it was averaging around 7%. And there are, and this year during the Turkish presidency, we will put a special emphasis, in fact, to see why this is happening. I mean, is it the cyclical, are these the cyclical reasons or the structural reasons? And now IMF and the World Bank, in fact, and WTO, they are all working on finding the main reasons of the slowdown of the trade, because trade, I mean, especially for LIDCs, for their better integration into the global value chains, is highly important issue. For SMEs, I mean, when I mentioned the inclusiveness, I think SMEs are highly important. This year, Turkish presidency, we have established now a global forum for SMEs in Istanbul. It was just inaugurated last week, in fact, in Istanbul. I mean, their role will be, because we have seen that SMEs do not have a strong voice in international fora. That's why we have established with the International Chamber of Commerce, they will be operating in Istanbul. They will be the voice of the, in fact, SMEs. They will defend their interests. Hopefully, they will contribute to the efforts of the SMEs to be better integrated into the global value chains. And as the Turkish presidency, let me say that we are very proud of. We propose to establish, I mean, there are some engagement groups, of course, with the G20, be like Business 20, Labor 20, Think 20, Civil 20, Youth 20. Now we are adding a new group, Women 20. It was accepted. That is a very important dimension of integrating more women force into the economy. Hopefully by October, I mean, we will be able in all the G20 countries, they will choose their representatives for Women 20. Shamsat mentioned about ODA. In fact, I mean, we are giving special importance, of course, within the G20 for the LIDCs and especially the, I mean, countries with special needs. This is the Turkish presidency's position. We think that the ODA is very important. It should be increased. Because, I mean, they play very pivotal role in some countries with special needs. We will be putting high, in fact, emphasis on that. And, of course, I mean, this conference in Addis Ababa will be very important because it will be the first one in order, I mean, if we can get successful results on the first conference, that I am sure that the SDGs in New York will be more successful. And G20, I mean, a Turkish presidency is supporting and will continue support the agenda. In fact, I mean, when I went to UN, United Nations, to give briefing to the General Assembly, when I explain what we have been doing within the G20, and most of the, I mean, delegates were pleasantly surprised, because, I mean, our agenda is very close to the SDG agenda. In fact, there are many, many overlaps, in fact, with the G20 and the SDG this year. And this is the Turkish priority, in fact, to give special support to the development agenda of this year. Maybe I will stop here. If you have some comments and questions, I will be very delighted to answer them.